The anime begins on the Summerforth continent, which used to have 7 countries. But then, the Ansel Kingdom took over 6 of them and became the Summerforth Empire. In the year 212, Kreitz and Ren were called to say goodbye to their father. Even though he was sad, Ars had to be strong because he was now the head of the Louvent family. Ars used to be an office worker in Japan with a normal life. Suddenly, he died and woke up as a baby in the Louvent family. He was confused at first, but then he saw his new mom smiling at him. He was really surprised when he saw a dog flying above his head. Ars Louvent was born in the year 200 in Lamberg, Mysian province. When he was 3 years old, he started learning to read and write. He began to understand that he was in a new world called the Summerforth continent. This place had magic, like in a video game, and Ars thought it was a different planet from Earth. Ars was born into a noble family that ruled a small land with about 1,000 people. The house was big and beautiful, like a castle, with many servants and chefs, so he could eat delicious food anytime. Ars felt very happy when he was reincarnated, but he discovered he had a special power that no one else had, which the ability to judge someone's talent. Ars found out that Malay was better at archery than using a spear. Thanks to Ars' power, Malay became an archery soldier. No one believed Ars could see people's abilities and talents, but his power was real. Sadly, he couldn't judge his own talent. At dinner, Raven, Ars' father, asked Ars to practice his talents because they would be needed when he became a leader. Even though Raven looked scary, he was very kind and caring. Since then, Ars started studying the country and realized the future didn't look bright. The corrupt government of the Summerforth Empire caused peasant rebellions everywhere. To stop the rebellions, the nobles in each region strengthened their control, but the country still suffered. If things stayed the same, the empire would collapse, and Ars would have to lead his troops. At that time, Ars really wanted to protect the people in his area, so he needed someone to help him. After spending a long time in the city and seeing everyone's talent, Ars felt tired. But then he saw Reitz, a person from the Marker race, who were usually taken as slaves. There, Ars gave Reitz a piece of bread because he was hungry. Ars didn't expect Reitz's talent and strength to be like a Japanese hero. Reitz thanked Ars for the bread and said goodbye, but Ars kept following him and invited him to be his follower. At first, Reitz refused because it might look bad, but after Ars told him there was lots of food at home, Reitz agreed to come along. At that time, Ars didn't like it when the servants gave him different food from Reitz. After Ars got angry, the servants started serving the same food to both of them. The butler told Reitz to leave after eating, but Ars got mad because he wanted Reitz to be his follower. In front of his father, Ars defended Reitz because no one had ever used someone from the Marker race as a follower. To keep Reitz from being expelled, Ars challenged his father to test Reitz's abilities. Raven agreed to give Reitz a chance. If his talent was proven, Raven would recruit him as a soldier. Hearing that, Ars was very happy because he believed in Reitz's abilities and talents. But the problem was that Reitz had to fight Raven directly. At first, Reitz struggled, but when he saw how much Ars believed in him, he finally succeeded. Finally, Reitz won the battle and, as promised, became a soldier. He was also employed as a servant. Even though it wasn't what he hoped for, Reitz still tried hard, although not as much as Ars. Several months passed since Reitz arrived. He not only fought but also stayed by Ars' side. With education, Reitz's wisdom grew quickly. Now, Reitz is the smartest person in the Louvent family. After getting to know Reitz's character, the family and people quickly accepted him. The servants also stopped looking down on the Marker race and Reitz, who loves learning. The next day, Reitz and Ars studied the history of the Summerforth Empire, which was in crisis. The current ruler, Bydoris XII, is only 8 years old. However, real power is held by his followers, who focus on factional conflicts, making the government very corrupt. Due to the government's failure, rebellions happened in many places. The governors of each state began to ignore the empire and strengthen their own control. The current governor, Amador, is in bad condition because he is old and might die in a few years. Amador has 2 sons. Traditionally, the first son would be the heir, but his younger brother was better suited, causing confusion about who should take over. If Amador didn't decide before he died, war could break out. Each province is divided into districts. Lamberg County was in Kanar County, and Ar's father was a subordinate of the regent of Kanar. Reitz said this was an opportunity. If they made a significant contribution in the war, regional leaders could be promoted. Reitz enthusiastically said they should gather strength and that he would always be with Ars to protect him. Ars felt grateful, and they planned to gather skilled people. Before leaving, Raven asked Ars to find someone who was an expert in magic because magic would be important in future wars. Soldiers who were good at magic could turn the tide of battles. Ars had tried using magic before but failed, so he had given up on it. Having magicians would boost their military strength. In the city, Ars couldn't find anyone with magic talent, even though he met many people. He saw many abandoned people in the alley, which made him want to build a better city for everyone. He didn't notice Charlotte watching him. Ars almost got tricked by a merchant selling fake dragon eggs, but Reitz stopped the scam. Seeing Reitz's serious look, Ars decided to be more careful with his purchases. Ars bought a lot of delicious food, but when he wanted to buy more, Charlotte stole his money. At that time, Reitz almost caught her, but only grabbed her robe as Charlotte escaped. When Ars and Reitz chased her, they saw Charlotte being attacked by thugs. Ars tried to stop the thugs because hitting women was wrong. The thugs didn't care and wanted to hit Ars, but Reitz quickly stopped them and fought back. Then, Ars asked if Charlotte was okay, and using his ability, he saw that Charlotte had S-level magic talent. Soon after, Ars invited Charlotte to become his follower. Reitz was surprised because Charlotte was a thief. However, Ars explained that Charlotte had great magic abilities. But Charlotte refused to become Ars' follower because she didn't trust nobility. Even though Ars tried to tell her he was different, Charlotte didn't believe him because she thought people like her from the poor area couldn't wait for change. At that time, Charlotte couldn't leave the city because she had to find food for other orphans like her. Ars understood and stopped trying to recruit her. Instead, he gave her money to help feed the orphans. At the inn, Ars heard screaming children saying Charlotte had been caught. Charlotte felt unwanted and alone because no one would buy bread from her. She felt like she didn't matter and didn't know why she was born. While Charlotte was being hurt and mocked by slave traders, Reitz arrived and defeated the guards. He also fought some of the bad guys and made them fall. Charlotte was surprised to see Ars there. And Albert, one of the bad guys, was angry and confused because he felt his place was being attacked. Since meeting Charlotte, Ars was curious about why she seemed so empty. He realized that Charlotte had lost hope for her future, which made him very sad. Albert even laughed, saying that slaves like her had no future. Listening to Albert's words made Ars angry. He believed that adults should protect children's futures, not take them away. Charlotte should have the right to decide her own life. Seeing Ars defend her so strongly made Charlotte start crying. Then, Charlotte told Ars to leave, but he asked her to wait. When the gang attacked, Reitz quickly stopped them. Even when more people attacked, he easily defeated them. Shortly after, Albert ordered his strongest fighter to attack Reitz, but Reitz still won. Ars then freed Charlotte by paying for her freedom. He told Charlotte to come home with him because everyone was waiting. But Charlotte said she wanted to go somewhere first. Afterward, Reitz tested Charlotte's magic abilities with a magic ball necklace. At first, Charlotte wasn't good at it because she had never used magic before. Shortly after, Reitz taught her, and soon, Charlotte caused a big explosion of magic, surprising everyone in town. Ars and Reitz were amazed by her powers. Ars was very happy, and Reitz admitted Charlotte's abilities. Charlotte asked for her salary to be given to the orphans she cared for, and she only wanted enough to live on. Hearing that, Ars happily agreed. Soon after, Charlotte and Reitz eagerly looked forward to Ars' future. After saying goodbye to the orphans, Charlotte joined Ars and Reitz. At first, Raven didn't approve because he thought it was too dangerous for women to fight. But when Ars told Charlotte to show her magic abilities, Raven changed his mind and asked for her help. In the year 206 of the Summer 4th calendar, 3 years after Charlotte joined the Louvent family, the Lambert County of Canar faced a conflict with the province of Sites. At that time, Raven fought many times, but his troops were happy because they kept winning, thanks to Charlotte, who was called the princess. Because of her, the Louvent family's magic troops were as strong as the infantry led by Raven. There was more good news that Ars got younger twins, a boy and a girl. Then, Reitz shared more good news, saying they found a hunter family that moved to Lamberg with two strong brothers who could be good recruits. When Ars and Reitz were going out, Charlotte, who was on holiday, joined them. On the road, Charlotte and Reitz kept arguing, and Ars watched his two followers with a smile. On their way, Ars and his friends saw two hunters who had just shot an animal. They were amazed by the hunter's skills. The hunters were very polite and asked if Ars and his friends were okay. There, Ars saw their abilities and realized these were the brothers Reitz mentioned. They were treated to a meat dish by the hunter's father, Gaetus, and his son, Marcus. Soon after, Gaetus asked why Ars came to their home, and Ars quickly said he wanted Gaetus and Marcus to become soldiers for the Louvent family. Hearing that, the father and his two sons were very happy because Gaetus and Marcus always wanted to be soldiers. Then, he praised Ars but spoke badly about his third child, Roselle, who was about Ars' age. While hiding, Roselle took a piece of bread and ran into a room, but his father scolded him for being rude. Roselle looked different from his older brothers, but Ars saw that Roselle had abilities and talents, with wisdom reaching a value of 109. Feeling so shocked, Ars even choked. Roselle's father apologized, saying Roselle was different from his older brothers and a bit awkward. But Roselle's father was surprised when Ars asked Roselle to become his follower. Roselle got scared, thinking he had to go to war, and ran into his room. But there, Ars didn't give up. He went into Roselle's room and told him there were lots of books at his house. Roselle got interested and agreed to come as long as his two older brothers could come too. At the Louvent family's house, Gaetus and Marcus were taken to the training ground by Charlotte, while Roselle was taken to the library by Reitz because Ars had daily lessons. Shortly after, Ars finished his lessons and ran to the library, where he saw Roselle asleep after reading so many books. Roselle quickly learned new words and understood them deeply by making further analogies. Ars was amazed that Roselle's wisdom increased so quickly in just a few hours. What surprised him more was that Roselle learned to read by himself because he and his brothers were never taught to read. To encourage Roselle, Ars told him there was another way to hunt, by making traps. Roselle then made a trap using his great thinking skills, which made his father ask Ars to take Roselle with him. Roselle's father explained that because Roselle was gentle like his mother, he didn't want Roselle to keep worrying about him. He acted rude so Roselle would want to leave. It's not that he didn't love Roselle. He said he loved all his sons very much. At that time, Roselle listened to his father's words, feels touched by that. The next day, Roselle went with his two older brothers to the Louvent family's house. Before leaving, Roselle promised that one day he would stay and live with his father again. Raven's health started to get worse, especially as the war continued. It all started a year ago when Governor Messian fell ill. The governor left a letter naming his second son as heir, but Cran, the older brother, said it was a plan by his younger brother, Basimar. Meanwhile, the older brother, who was once seen as incompetent, recently did well in battles. Because of this, many followers thought about choosing the older brother as the heir. This led to conflict in Messian province, with people supporting both brothers. Seeing this, the neighboring province of Sites attacked. At that time Ars, who was 9 years old, suspected he would have to go to war. But what shocked him more was that his father had arranged his engagement. Ars was confused because he just heard about it now. Panicking, Ars told his subordinates he got a letter from his fiancée. Then, he was told that his fiancée had arrived. And Ars, who had never had a girlfriend in his previous life, was very surprised. In that moment, Ars was confused about what to do. But when he saw her, he thought Lisha was very beautiful. He silently read her abilities and talents. Lisha's political ability was 100, and her ambition was 80. However, Ars was worried because her high ambition made her seem scary behind her sweet and calm attitude. Ars was not easily impressed, thinking it might be part of Lisha's plan to make a good impression and take their position. With his father's current condition, only Ars can stop him. Being a good host, Ars showed Lisha around. There, Lisha scolded her subordinate for being rude to Reitz because of his marker race. At that time, Ars noticed how polite Lisha was and how quickly she gained the maid's attention. Lisha was good at communicating, smart, and understood manners. Besides, she was very beautiful. If Ars didn't have judgment skills, he might have fallen in love with her. When the weather cleared up, Lisha asked for a tour of the city of Lambert. In the city, Lisha saw that Ars was very well-liked and loved by the residents. Unexpectedly, there was a dispute in the market between traders and distributors. Lisha asked Ars if she could settle the dispute in exchange for a reward. Using her political skills, Lisha managed to reconcile the two parties. Ars suggested they make a written agreement to prevent future issues. After that, Lisha asked Ars what kind of person he liked. Ars thought for a moment and said he liked people who were honest and open with him. Lisha smiled and said she understood and would keep that in mind. That evening, they enjoyed a banquet arranged by Reitz. Everyone had a good time, and Charlotte's beautiful magic made the event even more special. Despite Lisha staying overnight, Ars still had his own battles to face. Lisha then invited Ars to have a serious talk before bed. So, he thought all her actions were planned and had certain intentions. Ars didn't know if Lisha would believe him, but surprisingly, she did. Lisha said his actions made sense to her. Lisha then shared that her ambition was to be recognized by an extraordinary man. She said that after spending the day with Ars, she wanted to marry him. Lisha explained that the noble world was full of lies and that no one told the truth. Nobles often put others down for status and power. Lisha felt she needed to join a strong family. However, when she was with Ars, his kindness went beyond social status and power. Lisha promised that if anyone tried to stop Ars from creating a beautiful world, she would protect him. When Ars was 11 years old, Raven's illness got worse. The doctor said his body was getting weaker and told Ars to prepare himself. Ars was sad because he hadn't had the chance to repay his father. He hoped for a little more time. At the Arcade's palace, Governor Missian was murdered by an unknown person. The killer escaped by jumping from a high place and died, leaving no information. Raven, who was very sick, heard the news and asked Roselle what might happen next. Roselle said that a big war would likely happen soon because, without a governor, the fight between heirs would get more serious. From now on, the leaders of Missian province would have to choose between supporting the older brother, Lord Cran, or the younger brother, Lord Basemark. It's likely that Lemaire, the regent of Kanar, will choose Lord Cran. When that happens, they will also follow Lemaire's choice. Soon after, Raven told Ars and his friends that soon there would be an invitation from Lemaire and ordered Reitz to prepare the military so they could move at any time. Raven wanted to prepare as well, but his health was too poor to travel to the Kanar Palace. Reitz then said that an invitation from Lemaire had arrived for Ars. The invitation asked all regional heads to gather at the Kanar Palace. Since Raven couldn't go, Reitz planned to go with Charlotte as a representative. In the walled city of Kanar, Ars was ready to meet the regent. Ars wondered what kind of person Lemaire was. At the palace gate, the guard didn't believe that Ars was a messenger from the Louvent family because Ars was still a child. However, after seeing Charlotte, the guard recognized her as the Fire Princess of Louvent. Ars didn't realize that Charlotte was that famous and also recognized Reitz with the nickname God of Death Louvent. Ars suddenly became nervous, and Charlotte noticed. Then Minas, Lemaire's subordinate, welcomed Ars and his friends into the meeting room. When he entered, Ars, who was nervous, introduced himself right away because it was his first time meeting regional leaders. However, he didn't get any response, so Ars awkwardly chose to just sit down. Ars wondered why everyone was so quiet and thought it might be because he was still a child, making them doubt his abilities. Then Kral, the leader of the Khmer region, greeted Ars. Ars remembered that when he was little, Kral often played with him. Ars apologized for not greeting him first. Seeing that Ars was still tense, Kral even gave him a cake. Meanwhile, Hammond glared at Ars with a scary look, which made Ars afraid. Not long after, Lemaire entered the meeting room. After greetings, Lemaire announced that he would support Cran and that his decision was final. He asked if anyone disagreed, but everyone agreed to support Lemaire's decision. There were rumors that Sight's province might use this moment to attack. So, each region was ordered to prepare its military for future wars. The meeting ended, and Lemaire appreciated Ars for representing his father, even though he was only 11 years old. He also praised the Louvent army for being strong despite coming from a small area. Raven had already guessed that Lemaire would side with Cran. He thanked Ars for attending the meeting and saw that his son had grown up. Ars also kept his promise to reply to Lisha's letter. At that time, Ars made a promise to Hammond, so he must win the war and protect Lisha. Suddenly, Roselle informed everyone that Sight's province was moving its troops into Khmer territory, where Kral was. There, Lemaire ordered them to move there. If Khmer territory was taken, the attacks would continue into small areas like Lambert. Since Raven was too sick, Ars realized he had to go to the battlefield to lead. However, Ars was stopped by his own father because he was not ready to lead troops on the battlefield. Raven tested Ars by making him watch criminals being eliminated. If Ars could handle it, he could join the war. But Ars couldn't, so Raven led the troops himself. Even though he was sick, Raven bravely fought Seitz's troops attacking Khmer territory. At that moment Reitz, Roselle, and Charlotte helped him. There, Reitz fought by his side. Roselle planned strategies, and Charlotte used magic to destroy the enemy's fortress. In the end, Raven and his troops won the war, but he collapsed on his horse. The war lasted a month. Raven and the others returned 4 days after Ars' 12th birthday. Raven, now very weak, was laid on the bed. The twins worried their father might leave them, but Mrs. Louvent reassured them. The next day, Reitz and his friends were shocked to see a wound on Ars' face when he greeted them. Ars said it was just a training injury and not to worry. Then, Ars asked about his father's condition. Raven had done great on the battlefield, but after the war, he collapsed. Even though he was sick, Raven fought for a long time. Ars blamed himself for letting his father go to war. Late at night, Lisha came, worried about Ars. She apologized for coming so late and said she noticed something odd in Ars' letters since the war. She didn't feel any joy in them and asked what happened. Reitz explained that Ars felt helpless because he couldn't join the war and blamed himself for making Raven's condition worse. Soon after, a servant said that Raven had regained consciousness and asked Reitz and his friends to come in. Raven told them his life wouldn't be long and asked them to help Ars with his leadership duties. He asked Reitz, Charlotte, and Roselle to promise to support Ars and thank them for accepting this responsibility. After that, it was Lisha's turn to visit. She entered politely, greeted Raven, and showed respect. Lisha apologized for introducing herself in such sad circumstances. Suddenly, she was surprised to learn that Raven himself had asked her to be Ars's fiancé. There, Raven thanked Lisha for sincerely loving Ars and asked for Ars to be brought to him. And Lisha, who had just come out, was surprised to see Reitz and his friends still waiting at the door. She told them that Raven wanted to see Ars. Before leaving, Lisha thanked Reitz for caring about her and the Louvent family. Hearing that, Reitz cried, remembering his first time joining the family. He had to fight Raven, and even though Reitz was from the Markerace, Raven treated him like a human. Shortly after, Ars entered his father's room cheerfully, carrying medicine he had found and information about his father's illness from the books he read. Ars also mentioned a great doctor in the next province. Suddenly, Raven said that Ars had grown up. Raven started talking about when he was Ars's age and wanted to be a soldier. He shared stories from his childhood in a village with a cruel leader who imposed high taxes, making the villagers very poor. When he was 10 years old, Raven couldn't stand it and left the village for the city. In the city, Governor Missian visited, and Raven was amazed by his majesty. Seeing the governor's splendor, Raven's heart was filled with excitement. That's when Raven decided he wanted to be a governor, someone who takes care of many people. Since then, Raven learned to sword fight on his own and became a soldier. He fought hard, was noticed by Lemaire, and eventually became a regional leader. Time flies so fast. Followers, citizens, and family are all treasures to Lord Raven, and protecting them is part of his life. There, Raven told Ars that he wasn't responsible for his condition and it was all his own choice. He then held Ars's hand and passed his responsibilities to him. Even though he felt sad, Ars accepted. They talked all night, and Ars felt very happy. The next morning, Raven died. At his father's funeral, Ars, who was sad, had to be strong because the responsibility was now his. All the citizens of Lamberg welcomed Ars as their new leader, replacing Raven. At that time, Charlotte remembered how Raven cared for her on the battlefield. Roselle was asked to grow alongside Ars, and Lisha remembered Raven's last message to support Ars closely. Shortly after, Ars thanked everyone and took his place as the head of the Louvent family. Everyone bowed and paid their respects. 3 months passed after Raven's death. Ars was still getting used to leading the region, but he managed with everyone's help. Reitz then called Ars to see if he was ready to go. Before leaving, Ars visited his father's grave to tell him everything he had experienced. In front of the grave, Ars said he was not like Raven, but he would fight in his own way. At the Kanar Palace, Regent Lemaire remembered Raven as the most important person on the battlefield and a man full of talent. Lemaire led a prayer and then placed his hand on Ars's shoulder, saying that Ars was now the head of the Louvent family. Then, Ars introduced himself officially as Ars Louvent, leader of the Lamberg region. Even though he was still young, Ars promised to do his best. Soon after, Lemaire called a meeting right away, even though Cran and Basemark were in a truce. As a supporter of Cran, it was time to gather troops for the upcoming war. Then, Lemaire asked Minas to explain the situation. After Minas explained, only Perina Regency refused to negotiate. To invade the capital city of Arcandes, Perina District is the closest route. If Perina is taken, Cran's side can't establish an efficient supply line, increasing their chances of losing. At that time, Lord Lemaire wanted to make Perina an ally without fighting. But if negotiations failed, they would have to conquer Perina. Suddenly, Ars interrupted and asked for permission to check first if Perina could be consulted. All the leaders were surprised by his suggestion. A few days ago, at the Louvent family residence, Roselle said the situation was suspicious. Perina's refusal to negotiate was unusual. Roselle felt something was wrong. Under such conditions, attacking could risk a severe backlash. Roselle said they needed to understand the situation thoroughly first. The challenge was how to get the necessary information. Then, Reed suggested hiring mercenaries, specifically a group known as Shadow. If there was a meeting about conquering Perina later, Roselle suggested that Ars volunteer to handle the matter. After hearing Ars's explanation, Lemaire gave the problem to him to handle. Even though he was tense, Ars felt relieved because the meeting was finally over. They then went to the orphanage that Ars had built for children abandoned on the streets. The children, who used to be with Charlotte, were all grown up and called out Charlotte's name. Soon after, the caretaker of the orphanage greeted Ars, who hadn't visited in a long time. Both Ars and Charlotte were very happy because the children, who once had no hope, were now starting to pursue their own dreams. Ars was surprised when Lisha suddenly came to the orphanage. He was even more surprised that Lisha wasn't angry when her clothes got dirty from playing with the children. Now, Ars became more convinced that Lisha was a very good person. Lisha then asked Ars about his plans for tomorrow. He explained that he would invite shadow mercenaries to collaborate through REITs and give them jobs. Lisha was very happy with the plan and asked Ars to bring it tomorrow. Ars couldn't refuse that request because he wouldn't be home either. The next morning, Reitz told Ars that he managed to contact Shadow. After saying goodbye at the orphanage, Ars and his friends went to the place where they would meet the Shadow mercenaries. Using a password, Reitz got chairs for them to sit. Ars was very surprised by the people in the bar. At that moment, Charlotte didn't like the way the people there were looking at them and wanted to use her magic, but Reitz quickly stopped her. And Charlotte, feeling hungry, ordered food. Reitz then asked Ars what the mercenary leader might be like. Ars tried to find out by using his ability to see people's talents. He was so focused that he didn't hear Charlotte calling him. But then, Ars was very surprised when he saw a beautiful maid named Pham, who turned out to be the leader of the mercenaries and actually a man. Shortly after, Ars excused himself to go to the bathroom to check if his abilities were wrong. He compared Pham with Reitz and found out nothing was wrong. Suddenly, Pham came into the bathroom and pointed a knife at his neck. Pham asked how Ars knew he was the leader of Shadow. At that moment, Reitz came to save Ars and said that Lisha noticed Ars's changed expression. Lisha used her political skills to negotiate with Pham. Then, Pham asked again how Ars knew he was the leader of Shadow. At first, Pham didn't believe in Ars's talent until Ars mentioned his old name, Mazar, which no one else knew. Pham was surprised that Ars knew his name and started to like Ars, agreeing to work together. There, Ars said he hadn't met Pham before, but Pham could guess the people around Ars. Pham said he would support a winning horse, meaning he believed in Ars's potential. Pham asked to be paid 1 gold coin because it was his first time being hired, and 3 silver coins as a down payment. He promised to get information about the Perina negotiations. He told Ars and his friends to come back in 5 days. Ars was surprised that Pham could gather information so quickly, but for Pham, getting information was his job. At the same time, Roselle was surprised by Charlotte's big appetite and asked her to save some food for others. Ars and his friends then came back, and Charlotte said that Ars took a long time in the bathroom. Lisha explained that they met the leader of the Shadow and thanks to Ars, their request was accepted. And Pham, disguised as a waitress, gave food bonuses to customers and flirted with Ars, who was surprised by his behavior. Even though he was shocked, Ars wouldn't have known Pham was male if he hadn't seen Pham's status. As promised, 5 days later, Ars and Reitz came to the bar where they met before. Ars asked why the other troops weren't there. It turned out everyone was busy because the investigation needed many people. Ars asked again who was investigating his assignment, and Pham said he did it himself. Because it seemed fun, Pham handled it himself. Soon after, Pham said the investigation was successful. He explained why the Purina district did not side with the Cran faction. Pham then showed a letter with the signatures and seals of the nobles who sided with Basimark. At that time, the family that signed the agreement has the seal and signature of Purina County. But there's also a stamp from Masa County, which supports Cran. Hearing that, Reitz is shocked because this means Masa County has betrayed Cran. In that moment, Pham doesn't know why Masa County betrayed. But if Purina is attacked, Masa County will join in, and Cran's side will lose. This means Basimark will win easily. This is why Purina refuses to negotiate with Cran. Ars was very impressed with Pham for getting the information so quickly. Pham didn't want more payment because he already got paid before. So, he told Ars to take the agreement and see it as an investment for the future. Soon after, Ars said goodbye and promised to pay Pham a lot if he needed his help again. Ars then asked Reitz to tell Lemaire about Masa County's betrayal. At Kanar Palace, Lemaire couldn't believe that Masa County betrayed him. He asked Minas to send the agreement to Khmer. Before leaving, Minas noticed that the Masa County seal looked a bit different. Minas explained that the seal was the same as the one on another letter. It turned out that Basimark faked the Masa County seal to make Purina join him. So, Purina was tricked into thinking Masa betrayed and supported Basimark. Lemaire trusted Minas completely. Actually, Purina was just a pawn because the real goal was the explosive magic stone, a rare stone found only in Purina. The stone can make powerful magic and is good for making weapons. So, Basimark kept Purina to get as many magic stones as possible. Roselle said that attacking Purina was no longer an option because Purina should have been on their side. Then, the regent of Purina asked why their agreement letter was with Ars and his friends. Ars lied, saying that the Lamberg region also wanted to join Basimark. There, Ars was surprised by Masa's betrayal. Lemaire also decided to switch to Basimark's side. The region of Purina believed Ars's story and said he got the agreement letter from Basimark himself. Ars then asked why Masa County, which used to support Cran, betrayed him. The region of Purina explained that in battles, betraying friends to win is common. In the end, Regent Purina realized that Ars had tricked him. Regent Purina then told his guards to attack. Quickly, Reitz protected Ars from the sword attack. Ars explained that he didn't come to fight, but to tell something important to Regent Purina. The person with Ars, who was wearing a robe, was actually Regent Masa, who came to clear up the truth. Roselle had advised them, and it turned out Regent Masa never signed the agreement. At that time, Regent Masa came himself to clear up the misunderstanding. Then, Regent Masa explained that the agreement letter was fake and that he remained loyal to Cran. Regent Purina realized his mistake but wondered if Cran would still forgive him after going against him. Shortly after, Regent Masa advised Regent Purina to be careful and that the plan worked because someone controlled it. Finally, Regent Masa left the decision to Ars. Afterward, Ars explained Regent Purina's mistake but decided to forgive him because everyone deserves a second chance. This ended the conflict, and Regent Purina promised to help them in the future. Next, Basimark took the explosive magic stone from Purina. Ars was surprised when Lemaire told him that Cran wanted to talk to him directly and asked him to come right away. After uncovering a big scandal by exposing important officials, Ars was invited by Cran. Cran was a candidate for governor of Mycenae, so Ars was confused why someone so important would invite him, especially since other high-ranking officials would be there. At first, Ars felt unsure, but then he felt proud to meet these important people. During the trip, Reitz tried to boost Ars' confidence. To Reitz, Ars is great and someone to be proud of, so Reitz hoped the party would be impressive for Ars. Soon, they arrived at Sempra Palace for a big party. The nobles were excited to be invited by Cran. At that time, Ars was amazed because Lemaire was highly praised for his achievements, which made Ars proud of him. But their attention shifted to Cran, the important person hosting the event. Cran started his speech to welcome the nobles. Cran said some welcoming words and then greeted Ars because he wanted to introduce Ars to everyone. He believed Ars had done many good things for the region. Then, Cran announced that he was going to war. He shared his plan to unite the Mycenaean provinces and create the Mycenaean kingdom. After the party, Ars felt restless. Soon, Cran invited him to talk. Cran asked about Ars' view of his team members. Hearing that, Ars was scared and afraid to tell the truth. But Cran insisted that Ars tell him honestly, so he said that Cran's members were not very good. Cran's reaction confused Ars. But then he laughed and asked Ars to join his team. He promised to make Ars the regent of Kanar. This surprised Ars because he thought it was impossible for a small official like him to get such a big job. Cran promised to support Ars as long as Ars helped him in the fight. Quickly, Ars agreed and said he would fully support Cran. The next day, Ars and Reach tried to find good team members, but it was hard even though they were in a big city. Meanwhile, Basemark's followers were talking about their plan to make trouble for Cran, but their plan failed, and they had to get rid of the troublemaker. Charlotte joined Ars' team and was very excited and supported all of Ars' decisions. They looked for other talented people and got a recommendation from a shopkeeper. A woman named Mireille was suggested. The next day, Mireille was brought to meet Ars because she didn't seem to fit working in the shop. At first, Ars was unsure, but after reading her evaluation, he saw that Mireille was very strong, like a monster. So, Ars found a new member for his team. Turns out, Mireille is the sister of Thomas, an accomplice of Basemark. Mireille used to be an advisor to Governor Missian, so she had a bad reputation. Mireille knew people thought badly of her, so she accepted Ars' decision. Other team members didn't want her either. But Ars welcomed her with open arms because she was a special and rare talent. Soon after, Roselle told Ars about Mireille's cruel actions. Suddenly, they heard an explosion, so they went to check it out. At that time Mireille was with Charlotte, both of whom were tough women recruited by Ars. Lisha then appeared and supported Roselle and Reitz in trying to get rid of Mireille. So, a match was set up between Mireille and Reitz's teams. If Ars loses the match, Mireille will be kicked out. Mireille is on Ars' team, while Reitz and the others are teaming up. They started the match right away, but both sides had to follow the rules. If Reitz figured out the enemy's plan, they could surround them and attack fiercely. The match began. Ars and his friends sent a magician to sneak into Reitz's team. But the magician got caught using sneaky tricks, so Reitz decided to kick him out. They continued their journey, hoping to get rid of the enemy quickly. But Reitz and his friends met Ars' gang. Soon, they started fighting Mireille's team. Then, Mireille and Ars were alone. So they decided to keep moving, but they ran into Reitz's gang. Mireille told Ars to run away. At that moment Mireille, being a strategist, had a clever way to win the match. She made Reitz angry and told him to run, which annoyed Reitz because Mireille took his leader away. Then, Reitz told his team to catch Mireille. Soon after, Mireille and Ars' gang used wind and sound magic to shake the other team, as they weren't allowed to use dangerous fire magic. In the team, there was unfair treatment between old and new members. The old members decided to join Reitz, leaving the new members behind. Mireille then led the new soldiers to rebel against the old soldiers, causing a big fight among them. Meanwhile, Roselle was surrounded and decided to escape quickly to avoid getting caught. Shortly after, he helps Roselle so he doesn't get surrounded by enemies. There, Roselle uses the training given by Mireille, which helps him run fast. It turns out Mireille was training Roselle to make him stronger. Lisha realized that Mireille had planned this from the beginning to separate Reitz from his team. Even so, Reitz didn't let Mireille get to Roselle. But Reitz's plan didn't work, because Ars and Mireille attacked them with magic, and Reitz lost. After the match, Reitz and his friends decided to apologize to Ars for going against his decision. Hearing their apology, Ars forgave Reitz and his friends. Soon after, Mireille praised each member of Ars' team, making them happy to be recognized. Then, she had the idea to make Ars a king, so they all had a new goal. She led the members to support Ars in becoming emperor. This made everyone happy because they felt Ars deserved it. The next day, Mireille did her job as commander. She trained the soldiers to improve their fighting skills. After some time, Ars got a message from Cran. There, Ars told his team that they would carry out Cran's mission, as Cran wanted Ars and his smart members to join the next war council meeting. This made him even more excited to lead his team. Soon after, they decided to travel to Cran's territory. The anime will be continued. The moral lesson from this anime is if you want to be a king, just make sure your friends can run fast, do magic, and handle lots of crazy plans. And remember, even the biggest battles can be won with a good sense of humor.